I'm Asher Miller.
I'm Jason Bradford.
And I'm Rob Dietz. Welcome to Crazy Town.
Quick warning, sometimes this podcast uses swear words.
Language!
All right, guys, you remember, it wasn't that long ago, we had a Crazy Town season. Was it season 5 about the false prophets?
Try to forget it, honestly.
That was scarring. Mental scar tissue. You can't see it, but it's there.
I know. It was rough. We went through the mental ringer. And just when we thought we were out, they pulled us back in.
You gotta do it like Al Pacino and Godfather.
Right. Just when we thought we were out, they pull us back in. I don't know.
They pull us back in.
Yeah, something like that. Good.
Oscars for both of you on that one.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Well, here's what happened. Sometime, I think it was early October. I can't remember exactly. This guy, Mark Andreessen, who I honestly really hadn't heard of before. If I had, it kind of went in and out of my brain because he's kind of a low-level billionaire. Right. He's kind of, you know, he's not a very high level billionaire.
I'm pretty sure he's related to a share. Isn't this guy your uncle? Uncle
no, he's
Andreessen?
Not my uncle.
Uncle Mark?
Uncle Mark.
Yeah, no,
he's
but
a Silicon Valley guy.
I don't think I ever met the dude, but I know my dad worked with him early on.
I knew it.
Met him very early in Andreessen's career.
Yeah.
But no, he's not my fucking
uncle. So tell us about Uncle Andreessen.
Well, the precipitating event was that he comes out with a manifesto. And it's called the Techno-Optimist Manifesto.
I think you're mispronouncing that. It's the Techno-Optimist Manifesto.
Oh, however
There's two
you
O's
pronounce
there.
It.
Techno-Optimist.
This really set us off. But you give us some background, please.
Okay. Mark Andreessen.
Uncle Mark.
Stop it. It's not fair. You're right. He's a piddling billionaire.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, he's, I don't
What's
know.
He worth?
I think Forbes has him listed at like, under 2 billion.
He's a billionaire.
What's he on the list? What number?
Loser.
What number on the list?
He's 1,725.
Oh my God.
So he's the same level of billionaire as I am a hundredaire.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
If he was on the ATP tour, he'd be like way down in the Challenger events.
Totally.
Yes. Yeah. ITN. Maybe.
Looking up and wondering if he'll ever make it. You know, it's gotta be tough on him because all these whippersnappers, you know, they came along after him. He's early on, right?
Right.
So we're talking about a guy who helped start Netscape.
Jeez.
Some of our listeners might recognize Netscape. A lot
Netscape.
Of people won't recognize
thank you,
Netscape.
Thank you, Uncle Mark.
I still use it as my web browser. Yeah.
So Netscape was like, if not the first, one of the very, very first web browsers, right? And they were bought by AOL, so he made a bunch of money when AOL.
Sure.
Which
for
I still...
AOL. Yeah. We have to explain what AOL is. AOL dominated the home internet space for a while.
Yeah, right? I still use it. Dial-up. I get the CDs in the mail.
My favorite is when we get emails from people who still have an AOL address.
Right.
Yeah.
I fucking love it.
AOL.
It's incredible.
You know they're like 80.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's great. Which is great. I'm happy you're still alive.
Anyway, so, you know, and he's been in the tech world for a super long time, but he's definitely one of that generation who are not as well known now, but were very influential in the formation of kind of the internet. And, you know, he became an investor, has this big VC fund.
Right.
And I think he invested early in Facebook or whatever.
Sure.
You think the guy would be richer than he is.
I know, only a couple kind of billion.
Piddling. Piddling.
Yeah. So we sent this, you know, his manifesto made the rounds. It was a very painful experience. There was a lot of near aneurysms that occurred among us. So I think we need to process. I think we need to go through. We have kind of an intervention to kind of a cleansing to get clear-headed again.
It really is pretty amazing because if it had come out when we were doing that season, we would have had to have done an episode on it.
Yeah, you had to cover this.
You know, he would have shot number, like the insufferability index would have like keeled over and died.
It would have been, we have to like a level 11 on our guitar for him.
Exactly. Spinal Tap guys, we would have had to pull him out. You
yeah.
Know,
that would have been a great little like, you know, like little clip, little audio clip.
This guy, he just took all these
11.
Other ideas
number,
and just,
goes to 11.
He went to 11.
He went to 11.
With this fucking thing.
Each thing that you read in this manifesto, each point gets worse than the one before it. I mean, it just builds, and it's almost like a symphony that builds into a beautiful finale.
Okay, so what we're going to do is that we each get to pick one of the quotes.
No, I can't do that.
What?
Have you read the fucking thing?
Of course we did. I read it.
You can't pick just one.
Okay.
So I was going to try to pick one, and I couldn't do it either. I was like, well, no, that one's even better. Well,
when
I read this thing,
yes, okay,
yes,
I almost lost my mind.
Yes,
I put it away.
Yes.
Your mind or the document?
My mind.
You put your mind away.
I almost lost my mind.
I know. I'm so sorry.
I came back to it, and I was like, okay, I'm calmer now. Actually, weeks later.
Yes.
And I had the same fucking reaction.
It's hard to get over.
I mean, every single little bit, you just read through it. And it's like, what the fuck?
Are there any 80s horror movies that if you see it again, it's still scary? Like, Rob, is there any... Or anyone where, like, you know they're going to get, you know the guys behind the medicine cabinet.
Like Jaws.
Well, of course.
He's going down and then that head comes out of, like, the sunken boat.
Yeah.
I know it's coming.
Well, and then
it still gets me.
So this is like that.
The best horror movies of all time are from way back, right? Like The Exorcist, The Shining.
Yeah.
The Shining, when the
blood pours down the hallway.
Yeah.
Or when
out of the elevator.
Or when, like, the scene where she walks around and sees, like, he's been typing.
Oh yeah.
All fun and
all work and no play makes Jack.
I mean, I just my hairs go up. I know what you're talking about.
To our listeners, this is not a horror podcast. 70s horror podcast.
This
is a fucking horror podcast.
This manifesto is like a horror show.
This is the worst thing ever.
All right, well, let's just tread in real lightly into these waters of Andreessen. I saw a line real high up in the manifesto, early stuff, right?
Okay, early stuff.
Where
it builds on this.
He says, and he's a name dropper in this thing. He says, "We agree with Paul Collier when he says, economic growth is not a cure-all, but lack of growth is a kill-all." That's one of his statements.
I gotta calm down. Sorry, everyone. Our listeners are like, chill out.
So I was like, who is Paul Collier? Well, of course he's an economist.
Yes.
Of course. Yes. You have to have continuous exponential growth.
Yes.
You know, I like the old economist Kenneth Boulding.
Who had to quit in the mid-50s. He's like, I'm 55 years old or something like that. I cannot be an economist anymore. They're messed up.
Well, that's what he was the one who came up with that oft-repeated quote, like, anybody who believes in infinite growth is either a madman or an economist.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And so I guess Paul Collier's in that state. But
No, he's not. No, he's an optimist. And you guys are just downers.
Well, this one was great, too. Andreessen is an optimist, but he says this about universal basic income. He said, "We believe," and he always uses "we." Like, who's we, sucka?
He says "we believe" about 50 times in this thing. I didn't count them, but it's all over the place.
"We believe a universal basic income would turn people into zoo animals to be farmed by the state. Man was not meant to be farmed. Man was meant to be useful, to be productive, to be proud."
I've read a lot of manifestos in my research on false prophets. I did the definitive taxonomy. And so there's a whole history of false
prophets. We went deep into Stuart Brand shit.
Oh my God. Yeah. And so this was such a poorly written manifesto. I'm like, after all the manifesto writing that has been out there, you couldn't write a better manifesto.
And also,
than this.
Who's this we?
Is he it keeps a switching royal between we? I and we. He just like, there's a lot of inconsistency. No one edited this crap. Anyhow.
Well, he's too important to edit.
I digress.
Yeah. What you're talking about? Blood coming out of your ears, as Cheryl. Like, your ears turned into that hallway from The Shining. Give me some of your favorite hits from this thing.
I'll start small.
Okay.
And you just have to stop and just ponder the breathtaking audacities from these statements, because they're kind of banal when you read them. But then you're like, wait, hold on a second.
Okay,
so here's one for you.
Okay, here's a good one.
We had a problem of isolation, so we invented the internet.
That's why we did it.
And of course, the internet is not actually exacerbating people's sense of isolation.
Yeah, right? I mean, I think the big thing here is the lack of nuance, as usual. It's like, sure, the internet has made some connections. I mean, I think there's a lot of people who did feel isolated, who had whatever stuff going on in their lives. They could find others who had the same things going on, have a conversation. That's great.
Yes.
And it also has the guy sitting in his mom's basement wearing underoos,
going down a rabbit hole and turning into a Nazi, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, or you have the 13-year-old who's now got dysmorphia because she's looking at TikTok where they have AI make everyone look like a supermodel. I mean, thank you for lack of isolation.
She's not isolated anymore.
So the part that you're talking about here is Sherry. He has all these where he's saying, "Oh, here was a problem, and we solved it." Like, We had the problem of pandemics, and we invented vaccines.
Oh, I didn't know they got invented during the pandemic.
Well, and here's the thing about it is, you know how most evil villains twirl their mustache?
Sure, yeah.
Andreessen is just doing the wiping his hands clean. Like, he says we have a problem, we solved it with technology, and it's like it's done. He says that people were starving, so we invented the Green Revolution. Like, that's all done. It's all figured out. End of story. We solved it.
Well, exactly. So there's a line in there. Give us a real-world problem, and we can invent technology that will solve it. And you know what came right to my mind?
If there was a problem, yo, I'll solve it. Check out the hook while my DJ revolves it.
Exactly that, dude. He's like fucking Vanilla Ice.
He's Vanilla Andreessen.
Vanilla Andreessen. Okay, let me give you a few more, okay?
Doom, 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 doom.
I just love this
stuff. Doom, 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 doom.
I can't get out. I got an earworm now, man. Jeez Louise. I'm just going to go on for weeks.
We're going to get sued just like Vanilla Ice did by
no, but we're
going to
say
David Bowie.
Doom, 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 doom. Dang, dang.
No, he tried that defense already.
Okay, here we go. We believe markets are an inherently individualistic way to achieve superior collective outcomes. So let's think about some of the outcomes that our markets have created by.
Well,
they've priced
in climate change, so that's good.
Right. I mean, that's a superior collective outcome.
Yes.
Right? Climate change, biodiversity loss. Yeah. Pollution run rampant everywhere.
Yeah.
Extinction of
species. Well, I actually think Andreessen's pro-biodiversity loss. I mean, clearly just wants humans to take over every square inch of the planet and every square inch of space.
Well, he actually has a line. He says, we believe in nature, but we also believe in overcoming nature.
Yes.
We are not primitives cowering in fear of the lightning bolt. We are the apex predator. The lightning works for us.
Yeah, he strikes lightning bolts. Lightning bolts don't strike him.
The thing is, if you were to like put him on a show naked and afraid, okay, where he doesn't have any of this technology, he's not like Tony Stark in his little suit as a billionaire, how long would he last?
Well, that's his whole point, is that he doesn't need to do that because we have technology.
Because we have it.
Right.
So this is what's interesting, though, is like, you know, there's certain people who feel like they actually have to be a man, to be, you know, like a vibrant man. They want to be able to go out and be on the show alone, or, you know, like as a naked or afraid, or
like make something with your hands.
Yeah. Do something. This is a VC guy. This guy just throws money at shit and thinks he's a god.
Yeah.
This is ridiculous.
But he is a god.
But to his credit.
Okay.
I do have to say something that I like about this manifesto.
Oh, I'm glad
do you
to
believe
hear this.
There's something.
Yes, I want to. Let's clap at it a little bit.
It's what? We believe. He doesn't say markets are this or that. He doesn't say.
Oh, okay.
That he says we believe, which I could do that too. I believe I can fly. Isn't that another song we could play?
I believe I can fly. Wait a second.
Okay.
Oh, so you're
like
saying
that
we
about
believe
that?
Is his kind of you know he's.
Yeah, he's
it's
softening it
disclaimer.
A bit, right? He's saying...
We believe
it. I mean,
it.
A lot of people believe
it's
all kinds
true,
of crazy shit.
It's not
true,
but we believe it.
I mean, here's one he says. We believe in Milton Friedman's observation that human wants and needs are infinite. Well, that's great you believe it. It's not true. I've yet
our
to meet a human.
Our needs are infinite.
I mean, I haven't met many billionaires, but even they didn't have... infinite needs, right?
Yeah, I mean, aren't these economists who we love always talking about diminishing returns and, you know, on all kinds of stuff?
Oh, he's not into diminishing returns. He's in exponentially growing returns. That's what he believes.
But what's it called when it's like, you know, if you give someone who has no money $5, it's great. They're going to get a burger.
Right.
You give Andreessen $5 and it's nothing. So what is he talking like? I don't understand
You're
anything.
Trying to be logical.
Well, he has an amazing ability to pick anything out that he's heard and accept it as fact or some kind of underlying truth. Like, he says this guy, David Friedman, points out, he likes people named Friedman, apparently.
Yes.
He says, David Friedman points out that people only do things for other people for three reasons.
Mm.
Love, money, or force. Now... I don't know who David Friedman is, and I don't care that he said that. That's not true.
This is some bullshit.
Sometimes I do things for you because I think it'll benefit me. Mm-hmm. I'm not forcing you.
Right.
You're not paying me.
You're manipulating me.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
So that's a fourth one.
Yeah.
Manipulation.
Yeah. Cajoling.
Of course.
Look, you have an infinite need. You know, that includes exploitation of people and, you know, manipulating them. That's a need.
This is the best part, though, because he doesn't just say that David Friedman's right, that those are the three forces.
I love this quote.
He also says, love doesn't scale. So the economy can only run on money or force.
He's right, because when my second son was born, I had to take some of the love from my first son.
Right, zero-sum game, baby.
And give it to my second son, you know, because love doesn't scale.
Yeah,
you know?
So the economy can only be run on money or force. And then he says, the force experiment has been run and found wanting. Let's stick with money.
He's right. I mean, look at all those characters in Star Wars that use the Force inappropriately. It was bad. Bad things happened.
Here's another one. It's just like, I just, when I read this, I was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
We believe markets, to quote Nicholas Stern. You're right. He loves to name drop.
Yeah.
To quote Nicholas Stern, are how we take care of people we don't know.
All right.
The markets are how we exploit people we don't know.
Yes.
What the fuck is he talking about?
It's the opposite.
About?
In so many cases, it's the exact opposite
exact
of reality.
Opposite.
Well, but again, it's nuance, right? The market does help some people that are strangers to us. The market hurts a lot of people that are strangers to us. It's like, let's look at reality.
But is that why we have a market? So we can help people we don't know? No.
It's so that he can make billions. And then you got to rationalize
But he's only
it.
Got, he's only like worth $2 billion, though. So
I, know,
I mean,
he's
kind of he's like over.
I think
he's like thousand something down there on the billionaire
I think
list.
Some of
it's pretty
is
low.
Just, yeah,
he's, that's pretty low. Poor guy.
I like how he keeps talking about life in the stars. I mean, I think he's talking about in outer space, but he keeps saying in the stars, like you're gonna have gaseous human beings living at the center of a star somewhere. You know, like, just
so much of this manifesto, right? He calls technology the glory of human ambition and achievement.
Yes.
And that if we don't keep basically doubling down on technology, we're not gonna grow and growth is death and
yes.
You know, all that bullshit that we've heard before, right? He does recognize the role of energy. He talks about energy.
Okay, that was a high point, and then
high point, and then low point,
and then it went down very far, very fast.
Right.
So explain why. You haven't got the quote in front of what he says about that.
Yeah, I mean, so he said we believe energy should be in an upward spiral. Energy is the foundational engine of our civilization.
Agreed.
The more energy we have, the more people we can have, and the better everyone's lives can be. We should raise everyone to the energy consumption level we have. And then increase our energy 1,000 times. And then raise everyone else's energy 1,000 times as well.
And then, okay.
Right,
so,
we
so,
should.
So we do that. And he also is calling for the Earth to support 50 billion people.
Right.
So 50 billion people all living at the energy level of us now times 1,000.
Yeah.
I think that really doesn't work on the planet.
It's a good thing we can live in the stars then. You know, you're just thinking small here. That's the problem. You brought up population.
Yeah.
How's this for a fact in the manifesto? He says that developed societies, there's a word for you, developed, are depopulating all over the world across cultures. The total human population may already be shrinking.
Well, actually, it may not be. If you look at the statistics, actually, this is actually something you can look up. You can Google this, actually.
Hey,
so there's this thing called Google. So
it may
in fact,
already.
There's a browser called Google. It kind of replaced Netscape. You may not know this. And if you type in how many people are on Earth today.
And you can even chart
there's a clock.
It.
There's a clock. There's like a population clock.
Right.
It's like,
I know it's going down, right? The numbers are going
it's
down.
It's up by 3 every second, I think.
Yeah, but.
Oh, wait. The numbers aren't going
they're
down.
They're going up
it,
still.
It may be shrinking, though. It
no,
may
no.
be.
No, it may not be.
I think he's using, maybe using Netscape and AOL to look up these so-called facts.
And they haven't been maintained for a while, so who knows what's going on. Or maybe he asked ChatGPT and it just gave him the wrong answer. It started hallucinating. I don't know. I think he's hallucinating.
Well, and his answer to energy as a limit is first fission.
Sure.
And he talks about how we made just a huge fucking mistake not letting the enviros or the people concerned about security and safety, you know, shut down nuclear power plants.
Yeah, he's not
and of course, what's going to come next is fusion.
Yes. What's his take on sort of like, you know, some sort of caution with technology, or sort of like making sure we can regulate or govern it?
This was amazing to me. This might be my favorite part.
Really?
Yeah. Okay.
All right. We're getting to the good stuff.
The precautionary principle continues to inflict enormous unnecessary suffering on our world today. It is deeply immoral, and we must jettison it with extreme prejudice. Our enemy is deceleration, degrowth, depopulation, the nihilistic wish so trendy amongst our elites. I'm glad I'm an elite.
Yeah.
For fewer people, less energy, and more suffering and death. Because that's exactly all
I
we
know.
Want.
We've been calling
we want
for
more
that.
Suffering
We've
been and
calling
death.
For that.
Precautionary principle is deeply immoral.
He talks about enemies, right? And he doesn't,
we are then.
Well, he doesn't list people. He says it's only ideas. But he's really, really against the enemy of, put this in quotes, sustainability.
Right.
You know, like, what an evil notion, sustainability, to be able to live well on this planet for the unforeseeable future. Just horrible thing to believe in.
There's this interesting thing he has, this dislike of experts, which is interesting, right?
Well, he so-called his dislike of experts, but he has on their manifesto, right? There's a section at the end of it for people he calls the patron saints of techno-optimism.
Mm-hmm.
He's got like 53 people on there.
Yeah.
Those are fucking so-called experts, right? Economists and whatever. Oh, let me ask you a question because he sent me down this rabbit hole. How many of the 53 people, what percentage do you think are male?
I would say 90%.
I would say 98. Well, out of 53, it would be like... one woman. There's probably Ayn Rand or something on there. Yeah.
And what about weight?
I would say 95%.
Can we go above 100%?
No. So you guys are actually, you're being unfair to him.
I am.
It's 89% male.
I said 90.
And then depending upon how you define weight, you know, 92% are white.
I said 95. I exaggerated.
Now, if you...
I am so sorry, Uncle Mark.
If you decided that maybe Jews aren't like 100% white, I could do this because I'm a Jew.
Yeah.
Maybe say like a Jew's like half white.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, there you
then
go.
Then it's 84%.
Oh.
Because there are a number... You a talk about Freedmans. There are a number of Freedmans in there.
Kurzweil,
yeah.
I
went to this whole fucking rabbit hole thing.
I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
But those are, you know, he's got his experts. Well, he just doesn't like the other.
Well, this is the irony. It's like, I mean, I can see this. Like, there's a stodginess with expertise sometimes. There's certain fields like economics where, like, basically you're an expert in something that's just absurd and useless practically. But, you know, come on, be serious. Like, we're going to build a bridge or we're going to take a tumor out of your brain, Uncle Mark. I mean, who do we want doing this? So, again, there's no nuance at all anywhere. It's just one outlandish statement after another. We could go on and on. I mean, are we done?
Well, I just want to add one little point. It saddens me that you know, he doesn't have the diversity in his list of so-called experts on techno-optimism. But what really saddens me is we did that whole season. We spent a lot of time figuring out who is and who's not a false prophet. We even had a whole taxonomic treatment over here.
Yes.
If he'd have come out with this a few months earlier, we could have just taken his list and just
it would have helped.
Saved a lot of work.
A lot of research.
Well, for like certain lineage, the ultramodernists, I mean, this is complex.
The Cyborgians.
I mean,
he's got a couple of our guys on
the Rocket Men.
Speaking about the taxonomy of false prophets, he's basically a Cyborgian, is a species Cyborgian. And those are the folks that essentially believe in the ultimate fusion of humanity with technology. That's why you're called cyborgs. They eventually are looking for the singularity. So he does have stuff to say about that. He obviously believes we're going to go into colonize the stars. He seems to believe that AGI is, you know, artificial general intelligence is around the corner, and we should not slow that down at all. And to slow that stuff down would be akin to mass murder, by the way.
It would kill people.
So anyone who wants to slow things down about any technical project is like a mass murderer in his view.
I know this is a crazy thought, but do you think the guy is invested in AI stuff?
Oh my gosh.
Unlikely.
So yeah, so this is not about self-interest at all, writing this manifesto. And all his talk about centralized governments and centralization and I think taxes and government and all that, you know, like I'm sure there's no self-interest in that.
This is the other thing I don't understand is how these billionaires who land and take off in private jets and airports where there's air traffic controllers who get in their Tesla Cyborg truck or whatever it's called and who drive on freeways with like massive layers of concrete,
yeah,
and who have traffic laws that are being obeyed. So, and you know, who drink water that has been treated,
yeah,
who have their sewage treated, because they all shit too, just like everybody
they're poops. Working on that though.
So how do they, you know, who have a regulated financial system to some extent? So, you know, there's a reserve currency, there's a military industrial complex that sort of maintains U.S. hegemony. I mean, there's global trade agreements that allow for investment to flow here and there. And so, look, we can have a plant in Taiwan, and we can have mining of silica in North Carolina, and we can have, you know, carbon,
just
charcoal in the Brazil, all put together for the silicon chips. Like, how do they not understand this is the centralization of government and industry so that... How do they not get any of this? How can somebody
just calm,
in this position?
Calm. It's obvious. We believe that we're above all of that. We believe roads are useful to some degree, but it would be better if the government weren't involved in that.
Okay, he listened to season 4 of Crazy Town. It was all about the history and how, you know, how we have the Commerce Clause, and we went through all this stuff so that we could lead to this apex where he sits on top. Well, he's only 1,000 or something.
I have a feeling he doesn't listen to the podcast.
He doesn't listen.
You need to have a day in the life of Mark Andreessen and then find out what you believe after going through a day like
that. Well, okay, so here's I'm gonna psychoanalyze the dude a little
Let's
bit.
Let's do that. Let's help me out.
I'm sure he'd appreciate it, and I'm sure I'm
you're gonna have next time you go
on,
like, to Thanksgiving with him, with Uncle Mark, it's gonna be uncomfortable.
Yeah. Next time I hang out in Atherton. So let's think about this. I bet he doesn't really truly believe a lot of what he says.
What?
His stuff about centralization.
Uh-huh.
I think he understands. I don't think he's a dumb guy. I don't think he's unaware of the role of governance and international agreements and law and all these things.
Sure.
Like, because he benefits from those things.
Oh my
right?
God. Right.
He's just putting out a dogma. He's basically like, I'm going to tech bro the shit out of this, right? Like,
yeah,
we're getting people who are questioning technology right now. There's people that are scared of AI, are reacting against what's happening. Look at the Biden administration. They're thinking about trying to regulate and
sure,
demonopolize some of the tech industry, right?
Yeah.
There's people talking about the implications and the negative consequences of social media and these
sure
things. So he's kind of just trying to push
way
back.
Uh-huh.
Do you know what I mean? And
okay.
And that's why it's all a we believe stuff. There's no evidence here. I mean,
no,
he takes a lazy motherfucking approach. He's like, yeah, instead of giving you citations and references,
right,
just go read these people. Basically.
And you'll be,
you know,
just
I mean,
like me. He said.
You know what I mean? Because he can't justify and defend any of this stuff. And he fucking knows it probably on some level. But there are a couple other things happening here, I think.
Mm-hmm.
One is you've got this perfect alignment. Somebody we know and love dearly, Beth Selwyn, who's one of our advisors and is a great systems thinker.
Say her name again slowly.
Beth Selwyn.
Okay.
Elizabeth Selwyn.
How do you spell that?
S-A-W-I-N.
Okay.
And
people can look her up now.
Yeah.
Because I couldn't understand what you were saying.
And because I mumble.
Yeah.
She runs an organization called the Multi-Solving Institute.
Okay.
She was a student and actually worked closely with Danella Meadows, who we've talked about before.
Oh, so what does she believe?
So one of the things she talks about a lot about is sort of resonance and coherence between things.
Okay.
Right?
Oh my God.
And that's how system change can sometimes happen and operate at different scales, right?
Yeah.
Is if things are kind of resonating with one another.
Yeah.
And we have a situation with Andreessen where things are resonating. His self-interest, financial self-interest, and his worldview,
mm-hmm,
right, are reinforcing one another.
Yeah.
And the more that he has self-interest that believes in technology because he gets stands to benefit, and maybe he can climb up on that Forbes list because,
yeah,
you know, he's getting his ass kissed,
yeah,
right,
I know,
kicked
pretty,
right now.
I mean, geez.
The more he wants to double down on this philosophy,
right?
Right? And the more that he sees that he's benefiting from this philosophy because,
mm-hmm,
you know, his whatever, his investment account is looking good. It's
sure
a reinforcement that his belief is right. So you have that beautiful resonance,
mm-hmm,
you know, that's happening, that
yes
coherence. Lovely. The other thing I think that's happening is people are losing their fucking minds.
People are losing their minds. I mean, we had blood coming out of our ears,
yeah,
gushing because of this.
Yeah.
I'm going to wear these earphones for the rest of the day just to try to keep my brain sucked
into my
skull.
But doesn't there seem to be a little bit of both this sort of like fake machismo,
yes,
kind of like tech bro energy to this thing when you read it? Also like a doth protest too much.
Oh, it's
kind
very
of energy, you know, because I think there's a,
yeah,
desperation,
yes,
there a little bit. And I think the,
yes,
more you see people desperately trying to wash away the consequences of what we've been doing, like climate change and all these other things. Like, he doesn't mention it once.
Your psychological profile of him is so much more advanced than mine. I was thinking he didn't make the football team in high school and he's still
competing
there.
He got turned down
there
for the prom, you know, by his, you know. So,
look
like
at me now.
Next to a French class or whatever. I don't know. I also think there's an element there of what's called, like, you know, the dark triad of personality traits. And these are heritable, but they're also conditioned. And, you know, like the whole thing, like the economists become more selfish and narcissistic.
Right.
Based upon
maybe,
like,
even
just going to school.
Maybe even like Dunning-Kruger, the less you know, the more expert you think you are.
Right. So, you know, this definitely smacks of grandiose narcissism. And, you know, people in his position are very highly likely to score high in that, you know, and also these are related, you know, sociopathy and Machiavellian, those are the dark triad. There's a good chance, you know, we're reading his manifesto, but it's pretty obvious from the language he uses and his style and that a lot of that is probably going on here too. He's just got that going. He would be a pretty good outlier in these dark triad traits, I would believe.
I love this stuff. You're talking manifestos, dark triad. Sounds like some really intriguing movie plot or something.
Yeah. But I think, you know, what's also interesting is that, you know, in the season, we one of our false prophets was William McCaskill.
Mm-hmm.
Now, William McCaskill is very different than this guy. I mean, they're similar in some respects in that they are both this believer in tremendous progress, and they're looking for technology as a sort of this like long-term savior. But William McCaskill is more what you would put in the effective altruist side of things, okay? Whereas this guy is an accelerationist. So
Well, can we just define effective altruist first? I mean, we did a whole episode on this, right? We talked about it, but maybe you could explain to listeners, like, you know, who are maybe this is new to them, what it means to be an effective altruist.
Right. Okay. So we're going to get into Tescreol now or something like that. We got to be careful.
Oh, man. Now we're going to go deep into acronyms. Maybe we don't have to go.
We
got to
be careful. So effective altruism essentially is looking at the idea that one of the best things you can do is make a whole lot of money. And with that money, make investments that will spur sort of human evolution to the next stage. And this next stage is outlandish. It is this cyborgian singularity future. So the effective altruists believe in the long term of progress to the stars, of the fusion of humans with computers, the uploading of our brains eventually into machine intelligence and a fusion of those things. And it gets into the Ray Kurzweil stuff of wormholes and computronium. It goes out there, but, you know, eventually there's trillions of human consciousnesses, almost unlimited number of humans going through the universe. Now, the effective altruists, though, say to us, but we got to be careful about this, because if we're not careful, we're going to destroy the earth and destroy our civilization prior to us passing through these various technological stages. So they understand that technology is the way we're going to basically get out there and colonize the entire universe for ourselves, which is very narcissistic. But they also realize that it's a double-edged sword and we could kill ourselves off. So they're the ones that are like believers in the singularity, but are like, regulate, govern, go slow, unspool technologies at a pace that we can control them. Don't let the AI go Terminator on us. So you see all this stuff out there like that, where these people are pulling out of these major tech companies and writing stuff in, you know, The Atlantic or whatever, New York Times, basically screaming that we're going to kill ourselves off in the next few years if we're not careful.
Right.
That's the effective altruism crowd. Sam Bankman-Fried was in that. Musk is kind of like that too. But this guy is saying, screw all that. If you slow us down, you're a murderer.
Right.
So this is the schism in the singularity kind of universe, essentially.
Yeah, it's interesting because if you think about what happened with OpenAI, right? So this has been in the news, you know, recently, and sort of the leading company in the space of, you know, large language models. And, you know, they put out, we actually played with their programs, right?
ChatGPT and DALL-E.
And hugely successful, right? Totally. I think when they released it out into the world, OpenAI, their ChatGPT program.
Is it GPT?
GPT.
I know, it's so hard. They messed up on that acronym. I don't even know what it means.
They, you know, I think it was the fastest basically the fastest growth of any business ever in terms of like users, right?
Yeah.
And they just had this huge debacle. I'm sure our listeners are kind of familiar with the story, right? Where basically the head of the company, Sam Altman, was unceremoniously fired over a weekend or something like that by the board. And then there's a power struggle where a lot of the employees basically said that they would leave and they would quit. And Microsoft came in and basically hired Sam Altman
on the
spot.
Yeah.
No, they did.
And then
the board basically tried to bring Sam Altman back, and then they basically had a board turnover. Right?
Yeah.
So there's kind of like a, you can call it a coup in a sense. It certainly wasn't like an internal schism that happened within the company. And it's an interesting one. I think we have to be careful about those of us being, I'm certainly outside of this.
Yeah,
and I've
only
just read some things knowing exactly what's been going on.
Yeah.
First of all, it's very telling and interesting that OpenAI was structured as a nonprofit organization.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
It was started as a nonprofit. Its board were nonprofit board directors. And the reason they did that was because they felt that they were working on a mission. And this is very much connects to what you were
effective
just talking
altruism.
About, Jason, with effective altruism.
Yeah.
They saw the potential in AI and technology advancements, but they're also concerned about it and really wanted to make sure that it was done carefully. I mean, I think in some ways you could say Andreessen's attack on the precautionary principle is not so much even directed at us enviros, right?
Yeah.
As maybe even people within the tech space.
The effective altruists,
you know, who are concerned about it. But OpenAI, in a sense, was created and structured as a nonprofit because they were trying to like kind of walk that balance, which I think is an insane balance. But like they're trying to walk that balance. And then they had a situation where others are jumping into the fray. There are other solutions coming on board, Microsoft and Google and you know, others trying to develop their alternative technologies. They felt like they had to run out with their product, maybe before it was ready, or you know, before they fully understood the risks. They were making tons of fucking money.
You know,
billions was coming in. And all of a sudden, there's this opportunity to like just go balls to the wall on this thing.
Right.
And so there's this like internal schism.
Yeah.
You know, and we see who won out, right?
Yes.
The profit seekers, the growth, throw the precautionary principle out the window people, they kind of won this battle.
Yeah.
And it may be, it's hard for me to really know how significant the risks are with AI, but maybe we look back at this as an incredibly pivotal moment.
Yes.
Decision point, because it could have gone in a different direction.
Well, it also confirms Andreessen's point that money is the way, not love.
Yeah.
Love cannot scale, but money can scale into the billions really fast.
Exactly.
Now, all the incentives are basically there for the business opportunity to be captured by first actors. And if you slow down at all, which is what governance does, then sorry, you're behind. So until we have the government regulate heavily, but the thing is, this is moving at warp speed. How is any government going to know what the hell to do in any situation? They're going to know.
Can you imagine Congress having
hearings on this?
I remember Ted Stevens talking about the tubes for the internet. You know, like, imagine these guys trying to figure out what the hell this
AI stuff is. It's okay. Government is the enemy.
Right.
You can't get in the way. I actually want to bring it back to the manifesto and manifestoing in general.
Yes.
I mean, the fact that this guy thought, I'm the one to write a manifesto.
No, I mean, it wasn't I. It was we.
Yeah, well, the we. Well,
the royal we.
He himself and him or whatever. But
he switched back and forth a little bit. So I think, I don't know what's going on. But
it puts him in really good company, right?
Yes.
I mean, you got the Unabomber manifesto,
that
right?
That was one of the best.
Ted
very
Kaczynski.
Popular.
Those two would have gotten along swimmingly.
Yeah. What happens if you shuffle the two manifestos together? And what do you come up with?
Well, Kaczynski's is 35,000 words long.
Yeah.
And this is a pretty short one. Andreessen's isn't that long.
Yeah. So Kaczynski's was called Industrial Society and Its Future. Mm-hmm. And of course, it was that it doesn't have a future and we need to
end. It has to be stopped.
Industrialism.
Yeah. Now, the irony with that one right now is that I was reading recently, this was soon after Andreessen's came out, that this Unabomber manifesto is really popular again with like 20-year-olds. Mm-hmm. And they're like TikToking about it, ironically, and doing little one-minute downloads on this manifesto on TikTok. And
well, this is actually
just
one
what,
of
what he envisioned.
Yeah.
That was his,
well,
his dream.
Kind of was, in a sense. I mean, but I actually have this problem with Andreessen's manifesto that, you can see the life that Kaczynski's manifesto has taken on. I mean, that guy in Norway who shot up all the people, he basically excerpted from Kaczynski's manifesto, and others have too, and sort of warp it around. I mean, Kaczynski himself was killing people. I mean, what just absolutely crazy stuff. And so you wonder, like, who's going to glom on to Andreessen's and move that thing down
the
road?
Well, you know, we mentioned Sarah Pessin in our season on false prophets, and she has this system she talks about called spiral dynamics, where one thing feeds off another, and extremism begets extremism.
Sure.
And so the popularization of this manifesto of Andreessen's is likely to lead to a even further popularization of the opposite, which would be Ted Kaczynski.
And Thank God we are not popular. This podcast is not going to help at all. It's not going to make a damn difference.
But this is what I wonder about is, like, you know, is more and more of, like, what you're saying, people are going mad.
Yeah.
Because no one can regulate this technology. The nonprofit that was set up that sort of had the lead on it just got blown up and to become, like, you know, balls to the wall accelerationist, it kind of looks like. So you have people screaming that this is the greatest thing. It's going to, if you slow it down, it's a mass murder. And then you have other people who look like they're pretty much experts, like they used to work for that company, saying, no, we're going to kill ourselves off if we don't do something about this and govern it. And then you look at Congress and you look at the COP meetings.
Right.
And you're like, governance? What governance? So what do? Someone on TikTok pulls up Ted Kaczynski's manifesto and says, you got to blow it up. What's going to happen? I just don't know how we don't just go down this complete, just zany, scary time right now.
Well, the cool thing is that we do have some groups and people out there who are trying to inject some sanity into these sorts of conversations. Now, some of them have their own manifestos, right? There's the Dark Mountain Project that kind of came out with a manifesto.
Yeah.
I used to work for the Center for the Advancement of the Steady State Economy. We had a position statement on growth.
You didn't call it a manifesto, thank you.
Right?
I kind of have a thing against them right now.
But there's some other cool stuff, right? There's the Earth Charter, which takes a very ecological point of view of how we should treat the Earth and one another.
Mm-hmm.
Countries are putting into their constitutions clauses about the rights of nature.
Yep.
That's really encouraging. You guys remember the Natural Step?
I do.
That probably made the biggest waves, and all it was saying is some sustainability tenets. So, of course, Andreessen would hate it, but it was saying you can't continue to increase the concentration of pollution. You can't continue to use non-renewable resources, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
Totally makes sense and got some foothold.
Yeah.
But nowhere near, I think, the foothold of these extremist manifestos. What can we do?
Oh, well, okay. What can we do?
I mean, we got to somehow get past Andreessen and Kaczynski as the spokespeople of our times.
Yeah, well, okay. So I took this on, and you know I went through a very, very difficult time when I read this. And
you like disappeared for like a month on us.
I did some pretty big things. The experience of my life, I'm glad I'm back. I didn't know if I would make it back. Honestly, it was that kind of dire. But let me explain the process. Because basically, here's the situation. If you can't beat them with like sensible things, like Earth Charters and Natural Steps and these kind of stuff, right? If you can't beat them, if you want to remain relevant, if you want to actually get red, you got to join them.
That's right. Yeah. You want to compete with the big boys, then you got to be a big boy.
I'm a big kid. Look what I can do. I can wear big kid pants too.
Pull-ups, disposable training pants from Huggies. They go on like underwear and protect like a diaper, even overnight.
And I can pull them off and on.
When your child is ready, there's nothing like pull-ups.
Mommy, wow! I'm a big kid now.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, let's put on our big boy pants.
Pull them up, man.
Mommy, wow!
So, thanks for that, Rob.
I'm really glad, Jason, that you're taking the appropriate precautions, using the precautionary principle.
You can't beat him, join them. You think every morning Andreessen's pulling up his big boy pants?
I mean, when I read his manifesto, I feel it's about that level of intellectual sophistication.
Well, he doesn't have to go to the bathroom then. He could just focus, right?
I mean,
maximum productivity.
Totally.
You know?
Oh, totally. Okay. Yeah. anyhow, so what did I do? I had to devise an experimental protocol in which I put myself into the same sort of frame of mind as Andreessen, like this dark triad set of traits, you know, grandiose narcissism, et cetera. How do you do that? So it was quite a long process. It took me 3 weeks to get to the state, but basically it involved, I took a standard course of anabolic steroids as if I was a weightlifter, and that tends to lead to mania. Mm-hmm. I was allowed to take cocaine every Friday night for 36 hours.
Okay. 36 hours.
Well, up to, as long as I want. It was sort of self, you know, as long as I felt like it, you know, cool. that was fun.
I bet you had great ideas while that was going
yeah.
on.
I watched rocket launches like SpaceX constantly. I watched Tony Robbins videos. So, you know, give me the power.
Man, you could have written a good movie script during this time instead of writing a manifesto.
But the, you know, the key transformation, that was sort of like the set and setting kind of thing. You really familiarize that. I then went through ayahuasca ceremonies where, as I was setting up my brain to change, the ayahuasca ceremony with the, my sort of mantras and tenets about how powerful I was and how people needed me to write a manifesto that would change the world. I think that was transformative. So that I did a couple of ayahuasca ceremonies, and through this process, I was able to then manifest a manifesto. And I actually, by the time this is out, this podcast, the publication will come out in our journal, the Proceedings of the Royal Society of Insanis Civitatum. Sorry, but the manifesto itself is striking because unlike a lot of these manifestos, which we were talking about, they're often on the extremes.
Yeah.
I was trying to do this as a pro-social, non-sociopathic state of mind. So how do you get manic and narcissistic while still being pro-social and non-sociopathic? So that was my challenge.
I assume still being concerned about sustainability.
Exactly.
And,
so
and actually having enough faculty to put words on paper.
Yes. And so the mania helps with that. You can just write.
You were up for hours.
Oh, my God. And the coke. So that was the thing. Part of my mantra was about like bringing it all together, like synthesizing, taking all you know, and bring it together because we can't let society spiral apart.
Right. All these competing, very extreme alternative, you know, worldviews. Yeah.
Yes. So I came up with a consilience as my goal. Hmm. And so the manifesto is about the dehumanism manifesto is what it's called.
Dehumanism?
Yeah. It's a
How's
fusion.
That?
Well, it's a fusion of transhumanism and degrowth. So
interesting.
I brought those two philosophies together.
Okay.
But in the process, I also brought in a lot of different philosophies from our false prophets. Uh-huh. So I was really trying to. It's an incredible read, and probably it'll probably go far because it's completely mad.
Wait. What is this? I mean, what is dehumanism?
Dehumanism is this ability of humans to consciously evolve. So that brings up the species Conevolver.
Okay.
But using all this advanced technology, such as, you know, CRISPR and whatever, and selective breeding. I mean, obviously, the complex affixers love this.
Sure.
Okay.
The savior technology. Just get at it. What is this?
We turn into basically humans that are the size of pygmy marmosets. And because we have shrunken to such a level.
Oh, that's the dehumanized. Okay.
Okay, hold on a sec. For listeners.
So not degrowth. It
is degrowth. But I'm taking it with with a transhumanism philosophy. And transhumanism is going beyond our current state of humanity.
So our physical embodiment is shrunken down to the size of a pygmy marmoset.
Yes. I don't think the average listener probably is familiar with the pygmy marmoset an animal.
Well, the family, the marmoset and tamarin family are you know, the South America, Amazon basin, there's about 40 species, and they can be quite small. So we're talking like, you know, 150 grams.
Yeah, I went to the DC Zoo, and they used to let them roam around in the ape house free. They would like come right up to you, and it's like holding a hamster in your
hand.
So
we could shrink Mark Andreessen down and put him in the palm of our hand.
Correct.
And pet him, which is all he wants.
But the idea then is that if you're that small, there can be.
Oh, wait, there could be so many.
There's
of
so
us.
Many billions of us. And our ecological footprint would plummet.
Right.
Okay. So,
yeah.
So, anyway.
I love it.
I loved it at the time.
The marmoset revolution.
And, but, you know, once I reversed the protocol, right? Mm. So.
Yeah, how did you come back to us? Because you don't seem like insane steroid using coke sniffing
fiend
right now.
Talk about a whiplash. I mean, to go from that state of mind, well, a whole other set of sort of tenets and mantras. You know, I stopped the coke, I stopped the steroids, I stopped watching the Tony Robbins videos, et cetera, et cetera. I started watching nature videos, and I listened to Robin Wall Kimmerer, Reader Book, Brady Sweetgrass, and Mr. Rogers was a very popular video series for me. And and so I had a whole other set of reversals with another ayahuasca ceremony with my new set of tenets. I, you know, realizing we are just one tiny tidbit of speck in the universe that is 13.8 billion years old, and we're going to die. All of us are going to die. And eventually, you know, what does it all mean, really? You know, just be in awe that you're here and love, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So that kind of reset me, you know, sort of the opposite of Andreessen in many ways, right? Love doesn't scale according to him. So yeah, love was scaling
for me.
So
you went through a real Jekyll and Hyde, or like the Hulk.
Yes, kind of, Mark Russo, whatever his name is.
No. What was his
Ruffalo.
Name?
Ruffalo.
Bruce Banner. Right? Bruce Banner, Hulk, yeah, kind yeah. of transformation back.
Completely. So, wow. Anyway, the paper's out soon. It's out by the time this podcast comes out. So I'm worried, though. This manifesto may be too good.
Yeah.
You know.
Unlikely.
Well, I think we should propose to Andreessen that he funds. You know, I think you're starting a new program, right?
I'm very happy to announce I'm the new program director of a new program at Post Carbon Institute. It's called the Transdisciplinary Institute for False Prophet Study and Evolution. Hmm. So I'm the TIPSI program director.
Got it.
And we're looking for funding. How big is Andreessen's?
He's got 1.8 billion.
But how big is his fund?
Oh, his fund. Oh, I don't know.
35 billion.
Yeah, 35 billion. Billion.
So I figure we gotta scale, because there's this thing called Brandolini's Law, which says that to counter a bullshit takes 10 times as much effort. Right. So our goal is to raise
350 billion.
350 billion.
Right. And then we pour that into basically dehumanizing, you know, shrinking ourselves.
Now that I'm not completely batshit insane.
Can we hire the director of that documentary film series, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids?
Yeah.
Maybe he can help.
Yeah.
I think instead of asking for money, you should be asking for love, because that can scale.
Thank you, Rob. That is so sweet.
Every decision I've ever made in my entire life has been wrong. My life is the complete opposite of everything I want it to be.
If every instinct you have is wrong, then the opposite would have to be right.
Well, so we know we got to get past the extremism, despite your manifesto, Jason. I think even you, coming down from your experience, can admit that maybe that's a little extremist as
no,
well.
No, it's just horrible. It's absolutely that's what I'm afraid I put it out
you'd
there.
You'd be really cute as a marmoset.
Thank you. You would too, Rob.
So we're being serious now?
So yeah, what I would like to talk about is, if we're not in an Andreessen camp, we're not in a Ted Kaczynski, let's blow up our neighbor's camp, like, what are we doing to cope with the uncertainty that's in front of us? What are we doing to deal with the challenges of the unraveling that's coming? And I think you can just start with daily practices. Because one of the things, you got to get a habit that allows you to not fall into staring at this stuff too much.
Never read the news?
Yeah.
That might be the first thing.
That's not far off. I mean, I think of it as like distraction. It should be healthy distraction.
Okay.
You know, maybe don't fill your time with shopping and being on social media accounts.
Yeah.
But I mean, there are some valuable, like I like to use bicycling as a distraction,
sure,
for example.
Yeah. Have nice hobbies that.
Well, Jason, you bird, right?
I love birding. Exactly. I go out, it just totally resets, you know. Yeah. 110 species last month. I was pretty happy about that.
I also think finding some kind of mindfulness practice is useful. It's not necessarily the easiest thing to do. I've kind of had on and off again relationships with trying to learn how to meditate. But seriously, what you were saying about, you were joking about resetting yourself and seeing the world with awe and beauty, and it's amazing that I'm even here. That's kind of the state you're trying to,
yes,
to get to with those kinds of daily practices. So I think it's worth doing.
This is going to sound hypocritical, because in our season on false prophets and with this conversation we've had about Andreessen, we're being kind of dicks.
I know. Right?
So for me to say this sounds a little hypocritical. We're punching up, by the way, guys.
Yes.
This is what we're doing.
So, we don't have $350 billion in the in the new program.
wait, what?
I think it sounds, maybe sounds kumbaya, but practicing compassion and empathy and caring and giving and reciprocity and kinship, you know, as often as we can, trying to practice that on a daily basis. And in fact, I think it's important for us to have empathy with people who are turning towards what we view as false or dangerous responses to what we're dealing with. Because the truth of the matter is, you know, sometimes I think about this, you know, they say if you're nervous giving a public presentation, you imagine people in the audience in their underwear or something like that. I often imagine people as little kids.
Yeah, in onesies. It's nice.
In their pull-ups.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, we're all operating on some basic level, you know, as beings with the fears and the awe and the emotions or whatever of just living beings like little kids.
Yeah.
And I think that that's a lot of the energy that goes into people resorting to things, to tribalism, to yelling each other down on things. It's because we're scared, we're concerned, we care.
Yeah. Well, I'll give you a little credit there. I mean, despite your gruff exterior and your aneurysms from reading Andreessen's Manifesto and your wanting to make a pinata that looks like him and hit it with a baseball bat or whatever you're thinking of, I think it all comes from a place of it's so frustrating because he's putting out there in a very large public forum ideas that are exactly the opposite of what we need. And you just get so mad, but it's from a place of compassion, from a place of caring, from a place of wanting your kids to inherit a habitable world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm not going to spend my time writing love letters to Mark Andreessen, but I do think that in our daily lives that we operate, it's trying to step back in situations because we can all, I mean, I agree with what you said, Jason, is I see people spinning out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I find myself spinning out often. I mean, as we're recording this, there are thousands of people who have burned God knows how many tons of hydrocarbons to fly to fucking Dubai.
Yes.
To talk about how to solve the climate crisis.
They have a sustainable.
Hosted by an oil state.
And they have a sustainable yachting program.
Right. and they're all going to go ski in ski Dubai.
Yeah.
That stuff is like absolutely.
Yeah.
Maddening,
yeah.
You know? And so it's so easy for us to all spin out. I'm really worried about that. But I think that we have to practice not only self-care, but recognize that other people are going through
You
know, all kinds of stuff as things unravel. And if we don't show that empathy, we're just going to fall back into these camps where we're yelling at each other.
I'm pretty weak on the idea that there's free will. I know Richard Heinberg had a had a piece about that recently. I kind of agree with that. I'm really doubtful about it. So it does help me when I go, well, that guy or whoever I'm looking at who's doing something that is kind of driving me crazy, what happened to them? Like, what's their history? Okay. It sounds like judgmental, like what happened to you? But it's better than what's wrong with you. It's more like, what's the history that led you to this place to make this choice, to have this behavior? And if there's no free will, if we're all just products of like whatever genetic makeup our parents, you know, smashed together and the environment we grew up in, and for gosh sakes, if you grew up in late 20th, early 21st century, you can see how you could become a techno-optimist. I mean, it's crazy what's going on. You can see, given the media environment and all the self-interest there is of just keeping this going and promoting it, you could see how that could happen.
Yeah.
And we're the rare ones. We're the rare ones who are like not buying into all that crap. So I get it in some ways. I get it. I think it helps to have other people, though, that get it too.
Well, there's one other thought that I have that I think might help our listeners. I know it helps me. And it's, you know, you said we're the rare ones who are seeing this for what it is and are really concerned. There's a problem with that because when you go out in the world and you try to talk about this with someone, you know, I joke the chair of the wet blanket society.
Yeah.
Like, let's say you go to a family holiday reunion.
Yeah.
And you're kind of trying to tell people, well, I don't think we should do this. We shouldn't fly because of climate. Because, you know, it's like,
yeah.
You're the poo-pooing you know, nightmare of the family.
Yes, and I have been that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, and it's really hard to, aside from having to change plans, but even just talk about it, you know, to share your concerns. And so I think one of the most important things, like that's what we do on this show. The three of us get a chance to air our grievances, to say what's in our hearts, to confide in one another with these problems. And I think if you can find people in your life to do that with, if you can cultivate some friendships where it becomes safe to talk about these unsafe topics that, that bum almost everybody out, can be pretty therapeutic and a very useful thing to seek out.
I think people have a hard time finding that. I mean, I'd be interested to hear from our listeners if they feel kind of alone with all this stuff. We have heard from listeners that part of the reason that they actually listen to this podcast because it helps them not feel quite so alone because us idiots are speaking about things that they can relate to. So I think it's hard. And sometimes I think, like for me, I try to in some ways protect people that I care about from this stuff. I carry it for them in a sense. Because it's hard. It's hard to carry this. We talk about it as toxic knowledge sometimes. It's hard to carry that. But there are people out there who are trying to live in this space that, that I think we're trying to inhabit. And, you know, you joked about dehumanism as being this merging of transhumanism and degrowth, right? But behind that joke is this desire to find some, I don't know if it's a middle way, but it's finding our way through this where we're not actually saying all the quote-unquote progress and gains that we've had over the last few centuries of industrialization should go away.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? But let's keep the things that really matter and jettison the ones that are actually putting us on this course. And there are other people that I think are trying to figure that out too and muddle through. Mm-hmm. We at Post Carbon, you know, we have this website, resilience.org, and we're actually been hard at work at trying to figure out how do we create a space for people. A lot of our readers, I think, come to Resilience, thousands of them every day, I think, are struggling with some of these questions. And we've heard it again and again from people that when they've, even on webinars that we've hosted, people chatting with one another and then people wanting to connect afterwards, people are hungry for that kind of connection, maybe because they don't have it in their own communities. So we're hoping that there's an opportunity for us to play a role in making some of those connections. And that's one of the advantages of technology that we have right now is I don't know how long it will last, but there's a way of creating community that really is global in many cases. And I've been lucky enough in my work at Post Carbon to meet amazing people that I will never meet in person.
Right.
But I've gotten to know through the course of doing this work who I absolutely feel like are part of my kind of family.
Yeah.
You know?
It is amazing.
And I want that for everybody, because if we don't have that, we're going to turn it to Andreessen.
So what I heard from you is that we believe technology is the solution.
Yes, exactly. That's it. You brought it right back.
Well, I know I brought up this topic of cultivate relationships with friends, but fuck that. I'm going to go write a manifesto and outcompete your dehumanist one.
Oh, good luck, buddy.
That's our show. Thanks for listening. If you like what you heard and you want others to consider these issues, then please share Crazy Town with your friends. Hit that share button in your podcast app or just tell them face to face. Maybe you can start some much needed conversations and do some things together to get us out of Crazy Town. Thanks again for listening and sharing.